Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam wa tasliman kathira thumma ma ba'd. My dear brothers and sisters, tonight inshallah tabaraka wa ta'ala, as we continue our series Tafsir Juz'u Tabaraka, the 29th Juz' of the Qur'an, we are with Surah Al-Muddathir. Last week we finished Surah Al-Muzzammil, and today we're going to discuss together Surah Al-Muddathir, or the one who is covered up. What does that exactly mean? What's the significance of this surah? So when it comes to Surah Al-Muddathir, the ulama, and I don't know if you remember when we started talking about the Surah Al-Muzzammil in terms of the order of revelation. So the ulama, they all agree that the first surah that was revealed was Surah Al-Alaq. No doubt about this. At least the first five verses from Surah Al-Alaq. Then they now argue between Surah Al-Muzzammil versus Surah Al-Muddathir. Which one was the second surah and the second revelation? So some they say Surah Al-Muzzammil, some they say Surah Al-Muddathir, and then they say actually no, it's Al-Muzzammil, then Surah Al-Qalam, and then Surah Al-Muddathir. So there's like kind of like difference of opinion and the order of the revelation. However, the majority of the ulama, they say that the first surah obviously is Surah Al-Alaq, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, read in the name of your Lord who created. Then the second surah that was revealed was Surah Al-Muddathir. Why Surah Al-Muddathir? Because in Surah Al-Muddathir, Surah Al-Muddathir, Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda mentions Sahih al-Bukhari. He says, "Qala hadathana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faqala." So Jabir is now narrating from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi who said, "Jawartu bi Hira." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "I was sitting in the mountain of An-Nur. I was sitting in the cave of Hira, which means in seclusion. Jawartu meaning being in seclusion over there." And he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was contemplating and he was meditating to kind of find an answer, you know, and a meaning for this world. قَالَ فَلَمَّا قَضَيْتُ جِوَارِي. When I was done, he says, هَبَطْتُ, I came down. فَنُودِيتُ, and I heard someone calling me. فَنَظَرْتُ عَنْ يَمِينِي فَلَمْ أَرَى شَيْئًا. I started looking to my right side, I couldn't find anybody. Looked to the left side, I couldn't find anybody. Looked in front of me, looked behind me, I couldn't find anyone. Then he said, قَالَ فَنَظَرْتُ, he said, قَالَ ثُمَّ فَرَفَعْتُ رَأْسِي. So I raised my head up. قَالَ فَرَأَيْتُ شَيْئًا, I saw something. And that's, he said, when he ran to Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha wardaha. In the other, and then he said, قَالَ دَثِّرُونِي, دَثِّرُونِي, which means cover me up, cover me up. In the other narration, he mentioned even more details. He says, قَالَ فَرَأَيْتُ, so when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, when he looked up, he saw that angel, which is Jibreel alayhi salam, who came to him earlier before in the cave, came way before in the cave, he says, he saw him sitting there on a chair, like filling the space between the heavens and the earth. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was actually, his heart was trembling and he was so scared, and he went straight to his house and he started calling Khadija, zammiluni, which means cover me, and also dathiruni as well too. So the narration says zammiluni or dathiruni, and he asked that they pour some cold water on him, kind of like to wake him up, or at least basically to ease him down a little bit, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. So Jabir radiallahu anhu, from this he says that it was the first thing that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to Jabir, he says that Al-Muddathir was the first revelation. However, our ulama, they say actually no, it is not. But wallahu alam, the reason why Jabir said so, because when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received Surah Iqra bismi Rabbika alladhi khalaq, first in qata' al-wahi, the wahi stopped. No more revelation came after that. And the ulama, they have this difference of opinion for how long the wahi stopped. Why the wahi stopped? Anyway, why the revelation stopped? It stopped because it was more of a preparing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to it. Like he had the first encounter with the angel Jibreel, and now it's giving him some time to reflect on it and get ready for it. So now he's preparing himself salawatullahi wasallam alaihi, which is why according to Jabir he kept going to the mountain trying to find that angel again. He wants to find that encounter again, which is when the second encounter happened, when Jibreel came to him as he was sitting in the on that chair between the heavens and the earth. So that was the second revelation. So basically what we say here is that the first revelation was Iqra, and then later on came down the second revelation. Surah Al-Muddathir was the first that came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after that period of intermission between the first revelation and until it's resumed afterwards. How many days, how many months? Some ulama, they say it was actually as long as 2.5 years, but that's a weak opinion. Some they say 15 days, but the most common and popular opinion is actually 40 days between the first revelation and the second revelation. So the Prophet ﷺ was left to ponder and reflect and prepare and get ready for 40 days. Then came the command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to him, Ya ayyuhal Muddathir. So The Prophet ﷺ, as he was trying to find an answer for all these things, he sees Jibreel again in the skies, and he got terrified by that sight. It was a massive sight. So he came running to his house, to Khadija radiallahu anha. He said, Zammiluni, dathiruni, cover me up. And she did radiallahu ta'ala anha, wardaha. Now, why that intermission? Obviously, we said 40 days. That's when the Prophet ﷺ, and ulama, they say, Rasulullah ﷺ, nubbi'a, Rasulullah ﷺ, nubbi'a, biqra. So he became a prophet when the first revelation, read in the name of your Lord who created, came down. وَأُرْسِلَ بِيَا أَيْهُ الْمُدَّثِّرْ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. And he became a messenger with this command, or this ayat actually, that came in this surah. So he became a prophet, like Allah gave him the knowledge. Allah gave him that divine knowledge and that connection between him and the angel, Surah Jibreel alayhi salam. So he became a prophet. But he didn't know what to do with that information. He learned right now there is, of course, there is God, there is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is a superior being I've never seen before, such as the angel Jibreel. So he knew now there is something beyond this materialistic world. But what does he do with this knowledge? He doesn't know yet until this command to him came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is that first command, and what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the surah? So since now this is the second surah in the Quran that was revealed, obviously the significance of the content is very important to us to understand. What was it? The first portion of the surah was actually giving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the fundamentals of da'wah. Like you now, the Prophet, you're becoming the messenger right now. Your task, your duty is to deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the world. What do you do? How do you do it? What are your principles? What are the fundamental principles of your da'wah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the beginning of Surah Al-Muddathir gave the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam six fundamental principles of da'wah. So all my dear brothers and sisters who are out there giving da'wah, all these brothers and sisters who struggle and strive, you know, to acquire and achieve, alhamdulillah, da'wah among the people, you have to learn these principles. These were the fundamental principles by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commissioned the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to start giving the da'wah. If you don't have them, you're missing a lot. So it's very important that we study these principles, inshallah, together with Allah azza wa jal. So here we go. The first actually thing, again, Allah spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he starts speaking about some of the examples of the people of Mecca. And then towards the end of the surah, spoke about Jahannam and the punishment of the hereafter. So Surah Al-Muddathir begins with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once again with that endearment statement, Ya Al-Muddathir. We're going to recite, inshallah, the first 10 ayat, and then we start with the tafsir.
A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر والرجز فاهجر ولا تمنن تستكثر ولربك فاصبر فإذا نقر في الناقور فذلك يومئذ يوم عسير على الكافرين غير يسير.
So this is the first part of Surah Al-Muddathir. We begin, inshallah, with the first ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, O you who is covered up. If you remember when we talked about Surah Al-Muzzammil, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, calling him, Ya Ayyuhal Muzzammil. It was more like an endearment statement, like calling him, salawatullahi wasalam alayhi, to soften his heart, like making connection with him. This is like we said, you know, oh, sleepy head, just wake up, basically. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was covering himself up with his thawb, and Allah azza wa jalla is calling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to get up. Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir. First of all, in the Arabic language, Ya is harfu nida. So this is basically when you call somebody. And when you add ayyuha, this is usually is said when you call someone from afar. So when you call someone close to you, it says, ya rajul, which means, oh man. But when you call someone from far away, you say, ya ayyuha rajul, like calling from distance here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya ayyuha al-muddathir, not necessarily because he's far, no. Because sometimes we use ayyuha, instead of giving the connotation of distance here, no, we just simply to create extra attention. Why? Because when you say, Ya Rajul, some people might not pay attention to it, so they might miss that call. But when you add extra vowels and extra statement, extra words for it, it makes it long enough for people to pay attention to the call. So when you say, Ya Ayyuhar Rajul, So it takes longer time to pronounce, long enough for those who listen to pay attention to it. Instead of saying, Ya Rajul, which is basically might be so quick that people might miss it, but saying, Ya Ayyuhar Rajul, so it's long enough for people to hear it, so they know that you, they may be talking to you. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually talking to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by prolonging that call to make sure the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam doesn't miss it, to make sure that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pays attention to that command that is coming to him from Allah azza wa jal. Like as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually trying to attract the attention of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi. Ya ayyuhal muddathir. Ya ayyu, obviously there are two letters over here, two articles actually. Ayyu and ha is for the prolonging of the call. Ya ayyu, which means you, and ha is to make it a long statement just to call someone to bring their attention. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says over here, Ya ayyuhal muddathir. Al-muddathir. The word muddathir actually, what does it mean exactly? It's coming from the word dithar, iddathara, iddathru, or dithar. So we have in the Arabic language the word dithar. And you have the word shi'ar. The word dithar over here is actually the outer garment. When people, you know, wear these fancy, beautiful, you know, clothes that they put above, that's like saying the coat, for example, or that what we call, in the Arabic language, sometimes they call it actually aba or mishlah, which is basically an overgarment. And then you have a shi'ar. A shi'ar is the clothes that you put closer to your body, basically the one that is directly touching your body. It's not necessarily the underwear, but it's actually the undergarment that touches your straight, goes straight onto your skin, and then you put the dithar on top of that. In hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he was speaking during the conquest of Mecca, when he was speaking to the people of Quraysh and the people of Al-Ansar, so the Ansar were kind of like feeling a little bit left out, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he's going to go back to Mecca, he's going to leave Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called the people of Ansar to come in, and he spoke with them, you know, heart to heart. And he says, you know, you need to understand, don't worry about it, like I'm coming back with you to Medina. You have to understand, the people to me are all like the thar, which is the outer garment, and you, the Ansar, my shi'ar, which means like you are the closest to my heart, you are close to my body. Like you're dearest to me than anybody else. So the shi'ar is the inner garment, and the thar is the outer garment. Because the Prophet ﷺ was covering himself with the outer garment or with a blanket, and he's kind of like hiding behind underneath in salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Now, where this is coming from? Al-Muddathir, the actual original word is Al-Muta. Muta, Da, and then you have the Tha and Ra. Al-Muta-Dathir. So basically, this is what it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be at that level. However, in the Arabic language, pronouncing the Ta here and the Dal together became so heavy. Al-Muta-Dathir. Why? Because the articulating point on makhraj of the ta and dal are close. So the Arabs, what they did, they merged the two letters together. And when they merged the two letters together here, what they did is they merged the weaker letter into the strongest one. And the ta is a soft letter. And the dal is a stronger letter. So that's why they merged the ta into the dal. So the word became al-muddathir. Ya ayyuhal muddathir. Oh, you are covered up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was speaking to the Prophet salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi in endearment statement and language, and he is actually calling him to prepare him for a very special message. What is that mission of the Prophet salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qum fa'andir. If you remember at the beginning of the session here, we said that we're going to equip you with six fundamental principles of da'wah. So these are the ayat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing the six fundamentals of da'wah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like any mission, like there's a mission statement and there's a vision for the da'wah and there's a mission statement for it. So here's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been given. Number one, qum fa'andir. So this is number one, qum fa'andir. And then, wa rabbaka fakabbir. So qum fa'andir, which means arise and warn. Number two, wa rabbaka fakabbir, and glorify your Lord. Number three, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهَرْ, purify your clothes. Number four, وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ, abandon abominations, and basically kind of like abandon all the haram and the wrongdoings. Number five, وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْتِرْ, which means be generous in essence. And finally he says, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ, and persevere and be patient. So let's explain these, what do they mean exactly in details for someone like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who's been commissioned with such a heavy message, such as the message of the Qur'an to the world. And what would be the Prophet's mission over here? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, qum. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get up? Or in this case, arise. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was actually in bed, obviously. So he's just like, arise, get up, and be prepared. In the Arabic language, al-qiyam in the Arabic language, usually it's just when someone is lying down, someone is sitting down, and you ask them to get up, right? However, it's become now more common in the language when you tell someone, qum, arise, it means you mean by that statement is that you don't just stand up physically, no, actually in terms of even your mission, like you be focused. In this case, to put your effort, arise and start, you know, put in the energy and the effort, energize yourself. So qum here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to get up bi'azmin wajid. Like you have to persevere, you have to do it with azm, determination, and with earnestness. That's what it means, qum, because the mission that's going to come to you is actually so serious, requires your full attention. So the first mission, or the first fundamental principle of da'wah that you need to pay attention to is that your mission is not an easy mission. Therefore, it doesn't accept from you to relax, to slack, fall behind, you know, take extra time of recreation. It requires your full attention. You want this mission to succeed, you have to give it all of yourself. That's what it means. You have to give it all of yourself. Qum. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to do so. When Allah azza wa jalla said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, qum fa'andir. Qum. And then the next command was fa'andir, which basically kind of like given the purpose of this mission. What is the purpose? Your job, your duty, your task is to go earnestly out there and warn the people. Fa'andir. Why was it fa'andir? In the Arabic language, the letter, the article fa actually here, what we have here, is usually tahfiz, which means provocation, and also to incite. In this way, something positive. So basically, like giving Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an excitement mission, like qum fa'andir, like you need to stand up, you need to rise. Rise now, there's no time for you to sleep anymore. That's it, you're done with this. You need to rise up right now and start warning the people. Andir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first mission he gave to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, obviously is what? Shake them up with a nadara, which is basically the warning. I mean, some people might say, well, why didn't it start with al-bishara, with giving people the glad tidings or the good news? Here's the thing, because we're going to see that in the coming section of Surah Al-Muddathir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described to us some of the scenes of the Arab culture. Al-Walid al-Mughira, as an example, as was mentioned in the Surah, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا وَجَعَلْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا وَبَنِينَ شُهُودًا. Leave me alone with this man whom I've created him to be alone, and suddenly he have all this wealth and accumulated wealth and children and this and that. So speaking about the luxury of their lives. So they're already living their life as if they wanted to be in Jannah. So to start giving them, you know, kind of like an incentive of more of this might not be as lucrative, because they're already enjoying what they expect to be. This is, you know, for good. So therefore, it makes sense to warn them that what you have is going to come to an end. Therefore, you need to focus on that which is more important to you. That's why al-nadara or al-indar, to warn the people, actually makes sense here. فَقَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى قُمْ فَأَنْدِرْ. Be prepared, because what you need to do right now is a strong mission to warn the people. So you have to have the seriousness and the earnestness of that da'wah. Number two, قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. So the first mission the Prophet ﷺ was sent with is to rise up, be serious, be determined, be strong, don't slack, don't fall behind, and be excited about what you do. That's the first thing. The second thing, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. As for your Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet ﷺ, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, glorify. In the Arabic language, whenever you put the subject at the beginning of the statement over here, that means you focus on it more than focusing on yourself, actually the object over here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he starts by saying وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, it actually usually in the Arabic language, it would be also correct if you say فَكَبِّرْ رَبَّكَ, which means glorify your Lord, glorify your Lord, just like it was translated into English language over here, and glorify your Lord. That's the literal translation to it. However, the actual translation is not actually and glorify your Lord, no. And your Lord glorify. So when you say, and your Lord glorify, you bring the attention to what is most significant over here. And that is your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now saying, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. Your mission is to rise up, go out there with full determination and full excitement and full energy to warn the people. And what is now the main focus of that da'wah? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summarized for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the mission of his da'wah and the theme of his da'wah. What is that theme of the da'wah? رَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. You glorify your Lord. And since the da'wah is all about tawheed, which means to prove the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it suits to begin the ayah here by saying, your Lord glorify. Not saying, and glorify your Lord. No. Your Lord, the one and only, you need to glorify. So the mission of the da'wah and the theme of your da'wah should always be about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, a lot of people, when they go out for da'wah, subhanAllah, we try to kind of like to convince people with the miraculous nature of the Quran, talk about the heavens and the earth and the mountain and the rivers and this. And it's all beautiful, all sweet. It's all beautiful, all sweet. But what people really need to hear first is what? That this world is temporary and you are a creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and your Lord demands from you to pay attention to this principle of worshiping Him. You need to connect people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost. For all those who go for da'wah, when you talk to people, bring them back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with ubudiyah, the sense of servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are losing a lot of even our young brothers and sisters, the Muslim community. We are losing our young ones. Why? Because unfortunately, in our upbringing and our da'wah to our children, we don't focus too much on the heart to make them truly believe that their relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is servitude to Him. Which is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَرَبَّكَ, your Lord. He didn't say, وَإِلَاهَكَ. The word ilah means God. But he says, رَبَّكَ. Why? Because that's the first now introduction to the da'wah to the people of Mecca. And if Allah is going to say ilah and your God, they might not connect with that. But when you say your Lord, which means the sense of servitude, like listen, He is your Lord. It means everything that you see, the maintenance of your livelihood is coming from Him, from your Lord. Therefore, you need to understand your relationship to Him. He's the master and you're the servant, so serve Him. How? By worshiping Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. So when this was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you being the da'iyah, make sure that the theme of your da'wah is around Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not around you, not around a name that you carry, or a title that you belong to, or a group that you ascribe to. Your da'wah should always be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, what does that exactly mean? It actually means to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala بِجَمِيعِ صِفَاتِ الْكَمَالِ, that you glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with all the beautiful names and attributes that gives Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala absolute perfection, and to be free from any form of imperfection. That's the meaning of that. Does it mean also that you should also do takbir through teaching people about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Absolutely. That's the whole essence of da'wah, that educate people about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorify Allah in their lives and their hearts, and of course in your words. And the second thing they say, using the word Allahu Akbar. Using the word Allahu Akbar. They always, which is why, since Salah was one of the early commands that people were given in Surah Al-Muzzammil, as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made sure that they glorify Allah in their Salah. That's why we start our Salah with what? Allahu Akbar. In every position, we say Allahu Akbar. Why? Because it really means when you pray that you have interrupted everything in this world. You took kind of like broke away from anything in this world, and you focus on your Lord because your Lord is the greatest and greater than anything, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, at-takbir could also mean actually any kind of tasbih. It doesn't have to be only saying Allahu Akbar or Allahu Akbar Kabira. So saying subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah actually falls under the same command, fakabbir, which means to glorify Allahu Azza wa Jalla. So remember that your duty as a da'iyah, number one, to rise up seriously, no slacking, make be very determined and very focused, and go out there and deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the people. And the second thing, the theme of your message should always be revolving around bringing people back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorifying Allah azza wa jalla in the minds and the hearts of the people so that they know their position in terms of this dunya and with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the akhirah. Qala wa rabbaka fakabbir. What else do we know about rabbaka fakabbir over here? The same thing, like we said, this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used rabbaka to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, obviously because the mission was mentioned first, was sent to him. But it also applies to all of us right now. As we carry the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on his behalf to the world, we follow the same principle, wa rabbaka, our Lord, your Lord, you need to glorify. Next, number three, wa thiyabaka fatahhar. What's the meaning of that? The same thing, wa thiyabaka, thiyabaka, a plural of thawb, which means your clothes. Fatahhar, the fa is the same thing, letter fa, the article fa over here, same thing, to excite the Prophet about the mission. Like, as for your clothes, make sure to purify. The word fatahhar means purify. As for your clothes, purify. The English translation actually is doing it the opposite way around. But the Arabic, wa thiyabaka fatahhar. So there's ikhtisas, which means exclusivity. The exclusive, you know, attention to your clothes. Pay attention to that. Make sure that they're clean. But what does it mean when you say thiyabaka fatahhar? Does it really mean the literal purification of your clothes? Or does it have a deeper meaning, a deeper message than that? So the ulama, they say actually, al-thiyab, it means both. So it could mean the actual physical purification of your clothes, which is, by the way, according to Imam Ibn Tahir ibn Ashur, rahimahullah ta'ala, he says one thing interesting here is that this is the only place in the Quran, the only place in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing attention to purify our clothes. The only place in the Quran. The lot of ahadith, وَنَقِّرِ مِنْ خَطَائِكَ وَيَنَقَّ الثَّوْبُ الْأَبْضُ مِنَ الدَّنَسِ, purify me from my sins like you purify the thawb, the clothes from a danas. So there are a lot of ahadith about that. But in the Quran, the only ayah in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from you to make sure to keep your clothes clean. So the ulama, they say, it actually means the physical cleanness, which is something probably was not very common in that culture over there who don't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's najasa on their clothes. They might be clean in terms of, you know, they don't have actually dirt or anything like that. But they're not tahir. That's the thing. There's no tahara. And subhanAllah, living in the West over here, we see that. I mean, I see it when I travel a lot and I go into the airports. I can see people, mashallah, they're wearing fancy suits, probably thousands of dollars, you know, cost the suit. They go into the bathroom and they come back, they come out, they don't wash their hands. You don't even know that if they wash themselves or otherwise. So the clothes, unfortunately, they look nadif, which means clean, but they're not tahir, which means pure. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands that we purify our clothes physically. Obviously, with the purification of the clothes, as a Muslim, you need to pay attention very well and very clear to what you dress and how you dress. Subhanallah, some people, they think, you know, being humble is wearing, you know, untidy clothes and look messy and so on. That's not humbleness. That's not humbleness. Humbleness is when you dress up in the best way possible, but inside your heart, Allah knows that you're very humble. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from us that you take care of your clothes. That's what it means. The second meaning to this, the ulama, they say, there's also taharatun ma'nawiyya, which means that moral tahara. So it's not really about the actual physical clothes, because in the Arabic language, sometimes we refer to the thawb as to yourself. That's what it is. So therefore, they say, you need to purify yourself. That's what it means. What we call it in ulum al-suluk, the tarbiyah and education and the self actually training and exercise, is called tazkiyah. So we have at-tahara al-hissiyah, which means the physical purification of your clothes. And there's also a tazkiyah, that's the moral purification. Your a'mal, your deeds should be pure. Your intention should be pure. Your thought should be pure. So that actually essence of purification is a wholeheartedly, not just physical, but also in your mind, your heart, and of course the practice of your a'mal and your deed as well too. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands that from us to stay pure and to stay clean. So again, number one, rise up with determination, no slacking, carry the mission with you. Number two, you need to make sure that to make the theme of your mission always to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's all about Allah azza wa jalla, like bring people back to Allah. Number three, you need to make sure that you stay clean physically and morally as well too, which means your akhlaq, your manners, your tahara, you're completely pure. So that's a mission, which means obviously over here what? It means to us that you be the best example. So if you're going to be given da'wah and glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, show it through your example. And when Allah is referring here to our clothes, because that's the most visible thing, the most physical thing. When you go out, I mean, nowadays, everybody about fashion, right? SubhanAllah, everybody on social media, they show off with their clothes. How do you dress this? How to put that? What the kind of clothes they're wearing? And even when people go, so-called celebrities, everybody's just critiquing what they wear and where they got it from. It's all about clothes, SubhanAllah, the image. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing this to our attention, He subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us here a subtle message in it that people will look at you. The people will look at you. So they better see a good image, physically, emotionally, and of course morally as well too. So وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهَرْ. Number four.
وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. So the fourth actually mission here for us is وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. What does it mean exactly? Again, الرُّجْزَ was brought exclusively at the beginning of the ayah. So it's supposed to be وَهْجُرُ الرُّجْزَ, but Allah says وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. So what's رُجْز anyway? الرُّجْز in the Arabic language means actually, in essence, it means العذاب, means punishment or torment. However, he's not saying, you know, avoid the punishment. He means avoid the punishment or the torment or the adab by what? Avoiding everything that leads to it. Which why in the English translation, they actually brought the essence of it, which means an abandoned abominations. All the things that are considered haram, considered ithim and sins. That's what they said in the translation. But the actual Arabic language, it says, and avoid the punishment. The punishment, avoid that. Meaning avoid the adab by avoiding everything that might lead to it. And exclusively and specially, which is the first thing obviously that the mission came for, is to deny these false gods that they had. So basically, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stay away from the worship of the asnam. But hold on a second. So what does that exactly mean? Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam worship the asnam to begin with, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is now asking him to stay away from it? That is a good question actually. Some of the ulama, they ask this question, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was infallible, so he didn't do that. So what does that mean when Allah says to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, stay away from all these sins? Not that he committed them so he need to stop. No, it's actually asking him to continue on the path that you're on right now. Like you did well, so now continue to stay away from these things. So this is for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For us obviously and for the dua, remember that you stay away from these sins because we're not infallible. We're going to make mistakes. So you try your best to stay away from all these sins and all these things. So just like in the previous ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people will look at you, therefore make sure to present yourself in the best way, physically and morally. And then the next thing is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that, no, you're going to call people to stay away from the haram, and obviously you're the role model for them. So stay away from all these sins and all these, the worship of gods, false gods and so forth. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam obviously to stay away from the sins and all these bad deeds, what does that mean? He is implying that you need always to follow the best model of character, and that's when Allah Azza wa said about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa innaka la'ala khuluqin azim, indeed you are on a high standard of character. So we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was indeed prepared for that mission. Next, number five. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wala tamnun tastakthir. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْبِرْ. What does that exactly mean? Now, this has a nahi, like asking the Prophet ﷺ to abstain from something. And what is that over here? التَمَنُّن in the Arabic language is when you taunt people after you give them, you're doing favors to them. So when you give someone something and you keep talking about this, well, I did this to you, I did this to you, I did this to you, right? That's the thing. And that's called al-man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us from following that. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded in Surah Ali Imran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tubtulu sadaqatikum bil manni wal adha, O you who believe, in Surah Al-Baqarah as well, do not nullify your charities bil manni wal adha by keep taunting people with that and reminding people with the favors that you bestow upon them or you give them. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't taunt the people with the favor that you do, tastakthir, as if you're asking for them for mention or asking favors in return. Which means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be what? To be absolutely altruitive and also generous. So be generous, and when you do it, with absolutely no intention to ask for anything in return. As Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا. We feed you for the sake of Allah. We are not asking for favors from you. We are not asking for thank you from you. Absolute sincerity for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla commanding the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do that. But the ulama, they say, maybe there's actually another message into the ayah. What are these messages? Number one, so it could be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, لا تمنن على أصحابك بالبلاغ, which means when you deliver the message to the people and people become Muslims, don't, you know, taunt them with that. Like, hey, it's me who gave you the da'wah. I brought you to Islam. Don't do that. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who guides their hearts. Number two, like basic, as if you're telling him, those who are going to follow you, make sure to keep good connection with them. Don't let them go away from you by keep always, you know, taunting them with that favor that you did to them. Number two, don't taunt the people with your generosity. That if you ever do so, don't do that. And the Prophet ﷺ never did that to begin with. He was known as a Sadiqul Amin, the truthful, the honest, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. So, but again, it's a reminder to all of us, if you ever get to this point, never actually show that minna on the people, which is basically showing that favor upon these people. And number three, they say, لا تمنع على الله بعبادتك. Don't try to taunt or don't remind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your effort. Like as if you say, I did this, I did that. You don't actually show any favor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not bestowing any favors upon Allah azza wa jalla. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favor He bestows upon us, all of us. So here the ayah actually is about generosity, whether it's your money, with your akhlaq and your manners, and also with your patience with them too. Some of the ulama, Ibn Tarab ibn Ashur rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that here, when Allah was speaking about wala tamnun tastakthur, talking about generosity here, basically giving money, right? Charity. So as if this was ima'un bizzakah. This is like a reminder that there will be something, basically like there will be zakah over here, as if there will be a command that you'll be ordered to give wealth and money. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was ordering them and prepared the sahaba radiallahu anhum to give charity. They didn't say zakah yet because zakah became obligatory in Medina, but preparing them to be generous. Just like in the ayah here, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهَّرْ, some of the ulama, they say, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was telling the Prophet about your clothes, purify them, there was also an indication to the salah. Why? Because it requires purification. So, and we know that whenever Allah azza wa jalla speaks about salah, He combines that with zakah. So they say the mention of salah here, or tahara here, and then mention of giving here, that's the mention of salah and zakah in preparation to what's going to happen next. So, again, number five of the fundamental principles of da'wah is generosity. You need to be generous with your time, generous with your akhlaq and your manners, with your forgiveness, with your wealth. Generosity has absolutely no boundaries to it. That's how da'wahs succeed. Next, and find number six of the six principles of da'wah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. And again, for your Lord, you need to show patience. And what does that exactly mean? The ulama, they say, maybe that means actually, اصبر لحكم ربك, as in the ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, اصبر لحكم ربك, meaning be patient with the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because Allah told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the beginning of Surah Al-Muzzammil, إِنَّ نَاشِئَةَ اللَّيْلِ هِيَ شَدُّ وَطْأً وَأَقْوَى مُقِيلًا. نَاشِئَةَ اللَّيْلِ, which means the prayer at night is going to be actually very hard and difficult. So here's the same thing too. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preparing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is going to be a very difficult mission, requires your patience with the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the ulama, they say, probably because it means actually, اصبر لحكم ولربك فصبر على أذاهم, means for the sake of your Lord, you need to be patient and persevere with patience against their adha, which means their insults and their slanders and their torture and their, of course, you know, rejection. So he's preparing him, salawatullah wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preparing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for what he is going to be facing. Like he's going to be facing rejection, he's going to be facing resistance from these people. So Allah telling him, you need to persevere, never, never compromise your values. So for the da'iyah, number six over here, persevere in patience, do not compromise your values. Nowadays, one of the biggest problems we have in our da'wah, Allah musta'an, that a lot of the people under so much pressure, we're compromising some of the great principles of our deen. Why? Because we're looking for alliance with people. So we're looking with alliance with people that have maybe different values. And obviously I understand that at the level of highest sovereignty of the ummah, you are allowed to make certain alliances and certain, let's say, principles and so forth. But on a Muslim, you know, an average, you know, Muslim level, you don't compromise your values simply just to please somebody else. You need to hold on tight to your principles and remind yourself, these are the principles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires for me to hold on to and spread and share. Obviously, there's always, you know, dialogue, and there's always debate with people, and there's always, of course, you know, cooperation with people, but never ever compromise your values. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, do not compromise your values. So let's go back right now. Let's go back to the six principles, the six principles of da'wah, as were mentioned in Surah Al-Muddathir. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, qum fa'andhir. So the first one, to rise with basically with earnestness and seriousness, no slacking. That's it. You're always now determined and focused. Number two, وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. The theme of your da'wah should always to bring people back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorifying Allah azza wa jal. Number three, you purify yourself physically and morally, which means basically set the best example for the people. People, they look at you. Set the best example for them. Number four, وَرُّجَّ فَهْجُرْ. وَرُّجَّ فَهْجُرْ, which is basically stay away from all that which tarnishes your character. Akhlaq, bad manners, sins, and so on. Like basically, you practice what you preach to them. And number five, generosity with your time, with your energy, with your money, generosity. And number six, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. You need to persevere in patience and do not compromise your values. The six principles, the six fundamental principles of da'wah, those who are working in da'wah out there, make sure to hold on to them, inshallah ta'ala. In the next few minutes, bidnillah, we have the last three ayat here. Quickly, inshallah, we go over them, bidnillah azza wa jal, in regards to the next portion of the surah. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's now waking him up. Okay, you know that you're being commissioned for something serious right now, because from the previous ayat, you know what you're going to get. Now the command to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, get up, start your da'wah. Start your da'wah. Go out there, warn the people, invite them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Glorify Allah Azza wa Jal, and let this be the focus of your, or the theme, the focal point of your da'wah. Making sure in the process to set the best example for them. Abandon that which is bad. Exercise good akhlaq. Be generous to them. Bear with them. And also persevere, because you don't need to compromise your values in the process. And then after this was given to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now what the people of Mecca need to hear is that indar, qum fa'andhir. Go and warn them. Okay, warn them about what? What is now the topic of that warning? This is now what is happening here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presenting the first time in the Quran the warning that people should be aware of. فَإِذَا نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ. فَإِذَا, which means it's not if, no, it means actually when, which means it is happening. There is no question asked. It is happening. The question is when. That's what we don't know. So Allah is saying, he's not saying when, if the naqur, basically, or the trumpet is sounded. No. So when it sounded, like when it's happening. And it was mentioned in that fashion as if it actually was already happened. In the Arabic language, nuqira, basically, fa'idha nuqira. Nuqira, which basically means kind of like sounded. Anything like this is called naqra. So when the sound starts coming out of it. So what's the sound of the naqur? And naqur itself is the trumpet, which is basically is what Israfil, the angel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assigned to hold on to it, which is like the horn. And that horn is going to be actually blowing into the horn, sounding basically the end of time. That's it, it's over. So when Israfil sounds the trumpet or the horn, that means everything comes to collapse. The whole rotation of the sun and the earth and all the plans are going to come to a stop, and everything starts collapsing by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ending, of course, the life of this world and the beginning of the hereafter. So that's what a naqur is. How does it look like? The size of it? Allahu alam. But we know the angels are actually massive in their size. Now, the Prophet says and speaking about this in the hadith that Israfil, he says, he was one day he was seen agitated, salawatullahi wa sallam. He was asked, Ya Rasulullah, what's going on? You feel, look agitated. He goes, how do you want me to find rest? How do you want me to rest when sahibul as-sur, sahibul naqur, like basically the angel of the naqur or the sur over here, is already actually has put it on his mouth, and he's looking at the arsh in a way that suits his majesty. He's looking there, And he's actually waiting for the command to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means it could be in any minute. So فَإِذَا نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ, when the trumpet or the sur or the horn is sounded, نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ. So the threat is that telling the people of Mecca, whatever you live right now, whatever you have, is going to come to an end. That's the first warning. This is all going to come to an end. فَذَلِكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوْمٌ عَسِيرٌ. فَذَلِكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ. يَوْمَئِذٍ, فَذَلِكَ and يَوْمَئِذٍ is the same. Saying like, فَذَلِكَ, on that day. فَذَلِكَ, this one I'm talking about, on that day, يَوْمٌ عَسِيرٌ, it's going to be a very difficult day. So here's the thing. It's the first warning. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is beginning warning these people, but giving them hints. Not yet in details. Details didn't come yet, so it's going to come later. But for now, listen. When the day is going to come, when the angel is going to blow and sound that trumpet or that horn, which means that this life is going to come to an end, and that day is going to be a difficult day, not an easy day. To whom? قال الله تعالى, عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ غَيْرُ يَسِيرٌ. For the disbelievers, it's not going to be an easy day. So Allah using the word here, عَسِير and يَسِير. So عَسِير, يَوْمٌ عَسِير, which means difficult day. Didn't mention what difficulty, but definitely we know how it looked like in the Akhirah. And says, غَيْرُ يَسِيرُ, not easy, again, confirming the difficulty of that day. That's number one. Number two, when he says, يَوْمٌ عَسِيرُ, it's a difficult day, عَلَى الْكَافِرِ, for the disbelievers, غَيْرُ يَسِيرُ, uneasy, which means there's another option. You can make it easy. But how? By not being one of those people in that category of deniers. Instead, you need to believe. So you want to make that day easy for you? You want to make that day easy for you? You need to believe. Don't count yourself among this category of al-kafirin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that actually as, again, the first warning they ever get into, the Quran, and they receive from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam without much details, but the details will be coming later. Next, inshallah ta'ala, when you come next week, bidnillah azza wa jal, we're going to study a case study basically from the people of Mecca. How the people responded to that actually call from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring an example of Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا, leave me alone to him who I created وَجَعَلْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا, I give him a lot of money. An example of the people of Mecca, like setting an example for them so they would know how serious that matter is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And I want again to remind my dear brothers and sisters with the six fundamental principles of the da'wah. Number one, be serious about it, rise. No time to waste. Be determined and focus. Number two, make sure to keep the theme of your da'wah is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No slogans, no names, no titles, no partisanship. It's only Allah azza wa jal. Number three, you purify yourself. They look to you. They look up to you and they see you. Make sure to present yourself physically and morally in the best way you can. وَالرُّدْزَ فَهْجُرْ. So what you preach, you need to be the first person to follow and abandon the haram and the wrongdoing. وَلَا تَمْنُ تَسْتَكْتِرْ, be generous. Da'wah requires a lot of generosity with time, with effort, with wealth and everything. And finally, وَرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ, that you need to persevere with patience and obviously never compromise your values. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen to the speech and follow the rest of it, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.